was a crazy time. Wild. Venice, California in the 70s was a scene. Guys working out all day. That's what we did. People thought we were vain, shallow, but we were redefining what physical fitness looked like, using resistance training, heavier weights to reshape the human body, like no one had ever done.
At least that's what we thought at the time. I remember the first time I saw her. I was at the beach gym with the guys. We were warming up, messing around. I look over, there's this tiny woman in the sand, swinging a 50-pound kettlebell, like it was a baby rattle. I turn to Lou Ferrigno. I say, "Who the hell is that?" He just looked at me like I was crazy and he said, "Oh, that's Betsy. She's a badass." That a woman needs to get a man. Yeah, yeah. How can she lose with the suit she used? 36, 24, 36. What a winning hand. There have always been people who have shaped history from behind the scenes. Thomas Cromwell, Abigail Adams, Cato Kaelin. But what sets Betsy apart was the sheer breadth of influence she had. Many people have no idea.
Lance Armstrong's 7 Tour de France victories turned millions of Americans on to the sport of biking. Despite a later doping scandal, the rangy Texan is still considered by many the most influential cyclist in the history of the sport. In his autobiography, Armstrong credited his success to the long, lonely rides he took through the countryside after recovering from cancer. But a recently discovered trove of Armstrong's diaries from that period add previously unknown details to that narrative.
Cool, crisp morning here in Buffalo. Perfect for a training ride. Took off about 5 a.m., steady at 140 RPM, 38 miles per hour. At 40 miles in, I look behind me and some woman is gaining on me. Thought I'd lose her easy. Whenever I sped up, she did too. Tried to drop her on a small rise, but she blew by me like I was on some big wheel. What the hell? Gotta train harder if I'm ever gonna win anything. On the plus side, the nut felt fine. I never did find out who that lady was. I wonder where she is now. In the early 1980s, Jane Fonda had movie star looks, hair like a lion, and pelvic muscles that could crack a walnut. Disco already had people moving in unison to a tribal bass beat, but how that transformed into a generation signature exercise movement is what drew me to the world of Fonda studies.
Woo! Oh yeah! Work it out! Uh-huh! Let's go and do it!
In tracing the influences that converged into Miss Fonda's masterworks, primarily Jane Fonda's original workout and Jane Fonda's primetime, trim, tone, and flex, I discovered that she drew from myriad influences. Dance, of course, but also her observation of traditional folk exercises, and in particular, a sub-branch of vernacular stepping up fitness rituals she first observed in an upstate New York YMCA. Fonda was captivated by the intoxicating combination of precision stepping paired with polyrhythmic hand strikes. The ritual proved irresistible to bystanders who quickly adopted the primitive time step. Following the New York trip, Fonda returned to California, where she locked herself in her Malibu beach house for 3 straight months. When she emerged, the world would never be the same.
Here. Take your benches on your right side. Arms front and down.
Blues? They would be gone on the Delta. deep south, kind of a moan, a cry, the voice of the field hand, poor people who didn't have nothing.
The blues harmonica, or harp, was well established in the genre, dating back to when musicians would fashion them out of dried hickory and stretched cow intestines. But what many people don't realize is the evolution of the scaffolding most of us hear in our heads when we think of today's blues, the structure upon which the whole jam, if you will, is built.
Back in them days, we was messing with that old 9-bar blues. Sonny Boy Williamson, he had that 10-bar thing going on. And there's Milton Clubfoot Dupree, who tried 11-bar one time, but they shot him. And that brings me to the day long, long time ago. Freight train don't kick me off somewhere way up in them New York woodland where I stumbled into a jam session in a tent. People be woodshedding all night long. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. That woman was blowing a 12-bar riff. 12-bar! Damn! God damn!
You know, for years I was a full professor of psychology, of teacher psychology, but I knew nothing. I knew nothing. I had never even heard of these groundbreaking theories.
That was the fair-haired boy, I suppose, running around with Piaget, the frigid U of R, where we'd come to study early childhood.
Strolling to the laboratory, I encountered hordes of little children on their plastic sleds, off to the woods to collect the pine cones, and a little auburn-haired schoolmistress with a newborn baby lying all cozy in the giant snowbank. Brilliant! We sat at her feet.
Said she was just a regular teacher, and when asked how she arrived at her stunning new conclusions, often replied, yup, 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 no matter.
What did we learn from the Betsy Dexheimer? Everything. All of it.
I lost my yellow basket, and if that girlie don't return it, don't know what I'll do. Oh dear, I wonder where my basket can be. Oh gee, I wish that little girl I could see.
Well, I attribute my success in curling to Dolph Lundgren, Mother Teresa, and all the other greats at curling, but the mental game is all from Grandma Betsy.
Just a little yellow basket.